I mean, every time it rains, you don't know if this is the one. The city issues the alerts to move your car to the neutral ground. And believe it or not, that 2 feet will make a difference for someone.
If you live in New Orleans, you think about water a lot. The city is surrounded by it. To the north is Lake Pontchartrain. Then there's Lake Bourne, and to the south, the Mississippi River. New Orleans, with over half of the city below sea level, sits in the middle. Here's what that looks like from the side. The Mississippi flows a bit higher than sea level, and the city forms a bowl shape. It wasn't always like this. In the quest to pump every drop of water outside of the city walls, city planners inadvertently sunk New Orleans. Now, the city's tenuous relationship with water is changing. Officials want to hold it at bay, sure, but they're also trying to work with nature, as the city once had to. The land where New Orleans sits was formed by the Mississippi River, which carried sediment from Canada and the Midwest all the way down to the Gulf of Mexico. Along the way, the river created an enormous and ecologically diverse delta. For a long time, the natural topography of the land dictated where people could and couldn't live.
If you find a house that was built before 1900, odds are it wasn't severely flooded. And it really is kind of like a clear marker in time.
This is a map from 1895, when nearly all of New Orleans was above sea level. Most of the city's residents lived in the brown and orange sections. The rest is labeled sparse, rural, or simply not subject to drainage. It was essentially a swamp. A few decades later, the city had changed drastically. The Army Corps of Engineers walled off the Mississippi River with levees and Lake Pontchartrain with seawalls. It built canals, and the city installed pumps to move water to the other side of the walls, turning swampland into well-manicured suburbs. By 1951, all the areas previously labeled not subject to drainage were now part of the city. That's the power of walls and pumps.
It presents itself today as a modern metropolis, flourishing under the stars and stripes.
So the New Orleans drainage engineers got a lot right. They figured out how to move massive volumes of water very quickly and requiring not a ton of maintenance. These are very large pumps. But the drawbacks are many.
Near constant pumping lowered water tables underground, which dried out the soil and caused the land to settle. By 1960, over half of the city had sunk below sea level.
The history of New Orleans is the history of its relationship to water inequity. Our lowest elevation neighborhoods have historically been our poorest.
We live in the low-lying land. For instance, where we're sitting at now, this was the end of the city. Hence, it was called Back of Town, because it was, you know, back of town from the French Quarter and from the river. And so this was cheap land for African Americans to own.
Racial covenants and discriminatory lending practices helped keep Black people in the city's least desirable neighborhoods. Then Katrina hit.
When Katrina breached the levees that held the water back, the bowl was swamped.
More than a dozen levees failed. The Lower Ninth Ward was destroyed. Roughly 1,800 people died.
And in the poorer neighborhoods of that bowl, people who could least afford it have lost the most.
If the storm laid bare the city's systemic racism, the recovery process made it unmistakable. A couple of days after the hurricane hit the city, two-thirds of African Americans were flooded, compared to roughly half of white New Orleanians. A full week later, the first stat had barely changed, while the number of whites affected had dropped by half. In the years since Katrina, New Orleans has made a miraculous comeback. At least, that's what the city's leadership says. The Army Corps built even more walls, $14.5 billion worth of them. Over time, industry and residents returned to the city. But that's not the whole story. For one, not everyone's come back. There are 90,000 fewer Black New Orleanians now than there were before Katrina. And that's in a town of fewer than 400,000 people. For residents who have chosen to stay, flooding remains a chronic issue. In 2019, the Army Corps of Engineers said that without ongoing maintenance, the levees and seawalls could fail in just a few years. But there is some progress afoot.
Yeah, there's been a shift in thinking about how we manage water, an idea of living with water, nature-based kind of approaches to water management that are intended to complement traditional methods of flood control.
This goes against over a century of conventional thinking. Instead of rebuffing water with levees and concrete, work with it. These solutions are being developed at the city and state level, but those plans will take many years to execute. Residents need solutions to flooding now, not in 2050.
Since the levee failures, people realize that we can play an active role to help change our communities.
Angela Chalk is a fourth-generation resident of the 7th Ward and the founder of a nonprofit called Healthy Community Services. Chalk's organization has been offering immediate solutions to flood-prone neighborhoods. Their primary objective? Turn the bowl that is New Orleans into more of a sponge.
So if we collectively hold water where it is, then we reduce the risk of flooding in all neighborhoods. This is one of our neighborhood champions, Avery. Yeah, so Avery does urban ag and water intervention as well.
Walking down Angela's block in the 7th Ward, a largely black, working-class neighborhood, you may not notice the added projects, but they're there. These bricks are designed to absorb water instead of letting it run into the street. This bioswale soaks up water instead of funneling it into a storm drain.
It's used to capture water that's coming off of the rooftop as well as the runoff from the adjacent property. This block is at water capacity when it's 2,800 gallons of water per rain event, and that does not get into the storm drain. That's a significant difference.
These neighborhood additions complement larger city projects that are coming soon, like this high school football field that can quietly store water underneath the dry surface.
This field is going to store 4.8 million gallons of water.
While these interventions still can't match the scale of levees and pumps, that could change if more neighborhoods adopted similar solutions. And that could strengthen the city for the storms to come.
It's incumbent upon all of us to make sure that we're doing our part to reduce flooding in the city, if you love and care about this city.
That's a lesson other cities could stand to learn from New Orleans. New flood data shows over 14 million American homes are at substantial risk of flooding. That's nearly 70% more homes than the number that FEMA estimates are at risk.
Adapting to climate change involves the human landscape, the built environment, and the natural environment. You need all of that in the mix to really adapt to climate change.
New Orleans is at the forefront of a dilemma lots of cities will soon face. Stay and contend with the consequences of climate change, or leave our homes behind in search of higher ground.
I can't go to any one neighborhood in this entire country and say, why do you live here? That is not how decisions get made. We can't run away from risk, we have to face it. And each community has its own risks. If it's not floods, it's droughts. If it's not drought, it's heat. And we're all gonna have to figure out a way forward.